We couldn't have a more experienced panel of people all directly affected by knife crime. Alison, I want to start with you because you have brought something in that's especially significant and poignant. Tell us what happened to your son and what you have in your hands.
In my hands is my son. This is Joshua now, my little boy, my only son. Joshua went to a memorial event and got into an argument, and the young man that stabbed Josh left the party but then came back and decided to stab Joshua once. It went into Joshua's heart and he passed away 7 hours later. The reality of knife crime is these are people's children, not a statistic, not a headline, my little boy. And that's why, of course, it's personal to me, but there's a lot more that we can do. And I'm sure today will highlight a lot of those things that we can stop people's children becoming murderers, which will then result in a lot of more, less victims. So less people like Josh will lose their lives.
And you take that, those ashes into schools, don't you? Because you think that young people do not understand the reality. They're taking knives because they think they're protecting themselves.
Yeah, absolutely. They don't see how there's a link between carrying a knife and them losing their life or losing their families. And it's just to bring home the reality. Taking Josh in is part of that reality. And if it helps, then of course I will do that.
Justin, you were a former bus driver. You set up United Borders to help unite rival gangs in North London, the first project of its kind. 5 months after you launched that charity, your own son, Rico, who's with you, was stabbed 10 times by 7 men. You've been watching, I guess, the debate. You've heard Sajid Javid saying he wants more stop and search. Is he right? Is there a problem with stop and search? What is the answer?
I've heard you talk a lot about stop and search as well, and advocate for it.
Am I wrong?
Definitely wrong.
Tell me why.
Definitely wrong. For the simple reason, from the community point of view, we're asking for targeted searches because a lot of the people that are carrying out these crimes, they're known to social services, they're known to the police forces as well. So if it's targeted service, targeted searches before that. When you're talking about blanketed searches, we're walking back down to sus law days. There's a host of older black generation who are walking around with being suspected of doing something they haven't done, and they've got a criminal record as a result of that. Mm. Here you are advocating for something that doesn't affect you, but yet still you're asking for it to come back.
I hear your passion.
Yeah, definitely not passion. I've heard yours.
That's fine.
Yeah.
I'm going to give you some back.
Go ahead.
Okay? And it's this.
Yeah.
Do you accept that the vast majority of knife attacks happening right now in this country are by young black males on other young black males? Do you accept that as a statistical fact?
I accept that in Lincolnshire last year, they have the highest murder rate proportionately in England, but no one reports on it like that. I also feel that there's a media campaign to help the criminalisation of young black people. Because if I ask my white friends further out of London what they think of gangs, the first thing that comes to their mind is young black people.
Well, there have been 120 people killed in London from knives this year. Trevor Phillips, who was the former chairman of the Racial Equality Commission, wrote a piece at the weekend. I think only two were not young black men. I mean, at what point do we just, as he says, do we take the gloves off this debate and say what is going on?
At what point does Trevor Phillips become the voice for black people? When has one person become the voice for an entire nation? Never happens within your race, but yet still Trevor voice is the moral high ground in the opinion for black people. I've never seen him in a barbershop or a food shop. Do not tell me about Trevor Phillips. He has no credibility where I come from, none.
But that doesn't mean that statistically he's not right, right? And I would give you this parallel, right? And it's this. When we had a series of terror attacks a year ago in London, and it was deemed to be ISIS-inspired, right? What did we do? We demanded action amongst the Muslim communities of this country, right? And everybody thought this was a good idea, right?
Yeah.
What is the difference between the number of people dying from terror attacks, right, and targeting people where these attacks are coming from, and saying to the black community, these are young black men killing young black men? If I'm accused of racism, right, for saying what is a statistical fact.
Not racism, privilege.
It's not.
Hold on a minute, you're not the
I don't have to worry about my son's getting stabbed.
Can I respond to what you just said, please?
Yes.
I do not recollect, I grew up in the 70s, throughout the 80s, when the IRA had a bombing campaign throughout the whole of England, I do not recollect white Irish families being asked to talk on behalf of some white Irish extremists.
But white Irish families were targeted. They were.
What do you mean targeted?
They were. People were investigating white Irish families to try and work out IRA.
Yeah.
So they were.
Yeah, investigated. But I don't recollect a time when white Irish people had to apologise for their extreme attackers.
I'm not asking you to apologise. And I think you're taking this the wrong way.
I'm not
asking you to apologise. I'm asking you to accept a statistical fact, right? And then to tell me how, if we're not going to stop and search young black youths on the streets of London in particular right now, who may or may not have knives, do you find out if they're carrying knives?
I'm not saying that.
I really want to know.
Yeah, you really want to know?
Yes.
I've already said we need targeted stop and search.
What does that mean? Tell me.
So that means people...
Can I just say, because I actually used to do stop and search. OK.
As a police officer.
Exactly, 30 years. There's a difference between targeted, intelligence-based, community-focused policing and the stop and search that goes with it. Because stop and search is a blunt tool that's sharpened up with community intelligence. The more trust and confidence you have with the target group you're trying to support, the better intelligence, and then you target the right sort of people. At the moment, we have seen, even though the proportions is slightly improved, but still, one in five people come out with a positive when they're stopped. Whereas that means four out of five people are stopped unnecessarily. And unfortunately...
Yeah, but Christopher Dick would say, as she has said yesterday, that one in three stop and searches right now in London are revealing something which is either a weapon or intent to commit a crime.
Most of it is revealing drugs. I get the anger about
stigmatising people. What I don't get, right, is an absolute gloves-off acceptance that right now it's young black men killing young black men with knives. And I think if we start from that position, then we're all in the same game of trying to sort it out, right? I don't profess to know more than you guys.
I acknowledge that, yes, in London, but if you go up to Glasgow, I'm sure Will will tell you that majority, 99% of people, are victims and suspects are white.
Correct.
So you have to know the urban setting, the whole social political issues, because it's not just the fact that black men are just stabbing each other overnight. This has happened over decades, and it hasn't been dealt with, and that's why I've been asked.
Do you agree with Justin that Trevor Phillips is not a credible voice on this for the
absolutely. He doesn't speak for me. He doesn't speak for a lot of the community. In fact, his track record around race and equality is very, very very low as far as I'm concerned, because he wound down the Commission for Racial Equality that dealt with a lot of the issues that are impacting on the community now and brought in the Equality and Human Rights Commission, which I thought had nowhere the same sort of impact. And as a result of that, he does go into issues where he has no credibility and it's not based on fact. And I'll say this, if you start having a two-tier...
He's got a right to state an opinion.
Oh, yeah, but... To have a two-tier system that officers have are absolved from any sort of racially aggravated issues because of their stop and search powers is absolutely wrong.
Yes,
you cannot
have
a two-tier system.
Right,
it's one law for everyone.
If these were young, I've got three sons, right? They're white kids, right? 25, 21, 18. If 250 knife murders had happened this year and 95% of them were involving young white males, right? I would have exactly the same attitude towards rooting out young white males and stopping
knives. And no one is going against that.
It's the way you deal with it. You don't think I would, right? But I'm telling you, I would.
I'm not saying that. I said the difference is you'll see a resolution within a lot swifter than our community, because there's been a neglect when it comes to the black community. There has been neglect from governance, from policing.
But I can agree with you about that. I can agree with you about that.
No, but my thing is you don't become the moral authority.
I'm not the moral anything.
Yes, you have tried to position yourself that way. You're actually advocating that black people should be happy to be stopped and searched.
A lot of black people are tweeting me saying they are happy because they're worried about their kids getting killed.
Omar,
you've been stopped and searched. You have experience of this and you've managed to get yourself out of this situation.
I have. Look, and just to talk on what Justin's saying, targeted searching is so important.
Is Justin right? Am I wrong?
I'm not agreeing with anybody. I can talk from my experience and what I feel. I've walked down Edgware Road where I grew up with two friends who weren't black. I got stopped. I was in a shirt and trousers, they were dressed in hoodies. So why was I targeted? That's my angle. I know stops and searches in some way can prevent people from carrying a knife if there was a heavier outcome. You know,
what does it make you feel about the police? And is it aggravating? And does it make you feel like a criminal?
It does. It does when I'm walking with my mum and they want to stop me and search me in front of my mum. Mm. It's a disrespect.
Right, see, that's interesting. So this is about being targeted because you're a young black man.
Which happens. I've seen that. I said to the police officer, why are you coming to me? He goes, oh, you're a cheeky one. I said, why are you coming to me? I said, how about my friends? Mm. He goes, we have reason to believe you're carrying it. I said, why me? I put it to him.
To add to that, when was the first time you was rugby tackled by police? How old was you?
I think I was around 13.
And what happened? Young. What happened? Tell us.
And I was just with a group of my friends and we just got chased by, say, like five policemen. For no apparent reason, they tried to say we robbed the store, but we didn't at all. And
they were on their way back from table tennis. Yeah. They had table tennis rackets in their hands and you wasn't 13, you was actually probably around 11. Your younger brother was 10 and their friend was also around 11 as well, yeah? Rugby tackle, we live in Harrow. We kind of thought, okay, we've done well. We've got away from the rough, edgier parts of London. No, my son, first interaction with police was a spear tackle to the floor. Let me just be clear.
Yeah.
I am not having a go at the police. What I am trying to say is being quite clear from the McPherson report that there's institutional racism that has to be dealt with.
Yeah.
And when you're dealing with white people who are from out of the community, police in the community, culturally, they're not sensitive to the needs of the community.
Justin, I did a lot of campaigning at the Daily Mirror with Doreen Lawrence.
I remember.
Right? Yeah. And I felt passionately about it then.
Right.
That was a bunch of white, racist scumbags who murdered her son. Right? To me, I all I care about right now is there seems to be a pattern, and I'm going to come to you now, Pastor Lorraine. There is a pattern emerging, which is it appears to be almost exclusively young black men who are, for whatever reason, going out and stabbing other young black men. I don't know why this is happening. Can you tell me why this is happening? And what do we do about it?
Before Dwayne was killed, we had a big problem in Angel Town, and he experienced a lot of stop and search, which he wasn't comfortable about. A lot of the young people are not comfortable with how it's being done. Mm. But I'm utterly disappointed this morning because we're losing focus.
That's right.
We've lost our children. Mm. More children are dying on the streets of London. And we have done so much work collectively to put together the public health approach to safeguard our children. Right now, we have thousands of children that are terrified to go to school and they need education to have a good future. What I want to see is the emergency response plan for these children. Mm-hmm. They don't understand this debate. We should not be focusing on the police and stop and search. That has already, by law, been implemented. Mm. They just need to do their job properly.
What do you want to see happening?
What I want to see right now, emergency transport for kids that are most vulnerable at school right now because they're terrified of going home.
Yeah.
They've said the staggered times.
Yeah.
We need to support them with vehicles.
Yeah, safety, door to door.
We don't want them to carry knives. What do we want them to carry? Give them some alarms. These are suggestions what young people have said to me.
Why are they carrying knives, Lorraine?
The ones that are carrying knives, two reasons. One, out of fear. The second, because they're going out intentionally to harm, just like they did to my son.
Why is that happening and what do we do to try and stop it?
Why is that happening? There's many factors which has been discussed in City Hall, in the Parliament, on the media. Many factors. And each of those factors around social housing, the health and well-being of kids, the poverty issues, all resources for young people in the community, all of these things need to be tackled and dealt with, and they're not. Mm-hmm. And that's why we're going round and round in circles. And now, this morning, we're talking about stop and search. Mm. It's ridiculous.
Well, the Home Secretary has said he wants to see more stop and search. Cressida Dick, the head of the Met Police, also thinks there should be more stop and
search. Well, get on with it, but we need to help the young people in the community and the families. Right now, We're not concerned with what the police need to do. They're the law, they're being employed, they answer to the Queen. Do your job. But right now, the community, the families, they want to see what is being provided for my child in the school, in the community, and the things we're dealing with at home. None of that is being spoken about. So the community feel that nothing is happening. Yeah. And the children, which are most important, are so vulnerable right now because they don't understand all this politics.
They need to be protected, not targeted.
Mm. Protected. And that's what we need to be telling our future generations.
And you're also saying, unless I'm misunderstanding, that actually, by the time you get to stop and search, it's too late.
Yeah.
Decisions have been taken, right?
Kids have decided.
What you've got to try and get inside it, you've got to get inside the problems that are creating
youth
the environment.
Youth services, well, alternative
they're taking knives
activities.
Up, right?
That's correct.
Am I misinterpreting you?
No, you're not.
OK.
No, so those early interventions and prevention programmes that used to be implemented has been run into the ground because of austerity, safeguarding agencies, including police, have been run into the ground. And they need to start building those... initiatives back up. And we have to start showing, as Lorraine has said, the public health approach. I myself and Duncan have worked on a youth violence commission, and our first recommendation was a London violence reduction unit. And I think that holistic approach needs to be brought in, recognising the trauma that a lot of the target group are going through and starting to get a centred approach on young people.
That's
working
what
Sadiq
Khan wants to do. In Glasgow, we've got the Deputy Director of the Scottish Violence Reduction Unit, Will Linden. In 2005, the World Health Organization said Glasgow was the murder capital of Europe. This year, the city had its lowest murder rate since records began. How have you done it?
Well, it's not been easy. It's been a long journey with this. I mean, back in 2005, the murder rate for Glasgow put us somewhere in the region of about 5.2 per 100,000. Glasgow lost 44 lives in 1 year, half of which to stabbing, a huge proportion to young people. And we had enough of it. I mean, I'm listening to the voices around the table today, and people are rightfully angry. They're rightfully scared. They're rightfully annoyed about losing, tragically losing our children, because that's what it is. But we decided to change. We decided that enough was enough and we had to do something different. So it was about policing, it was about communities, it was about partners in health and education, and most importantly, it was about partners in the community. Because whatever we wanted to do, we realised that we didn't have all the solutions for it, we didn't have all the answers. It was those closest to the problem, those working with young people on a day-to-day basis, those that understood the issues, who was the ones that had the solutions for it. So what we had to do was listen. We had to listen to people and we had to take action. And it's taken us 10 years to do this. It's taking us a generation. But that doesn't mean you write off people just now, because you can't afford to, because we are talking about people's lives. And this is why it's important, when we listen to the voices around the room today, that we get together, that we look for solutions for this. Because there's so much passion, there is so much belief, there is so much wanting a will to change things, that collectively we can change things, but only if we work together.
Well, thank you. Duncan Bew is a consultant trauma surgeon, and you're also part of the anti-knife charity Growing Against Violence. You see firsthand, presumably far too regularly, and how often do you see children?
We do. So we've seen a steady increase in interpersonal violence over the last few years, around 30 to 40%.
You're in South London, right?
I'm in South London, work at King's, that's right. But in particular, young people, in particular from our most disadvantaged communities. And the key thing is here that wherever across the country we see people coming in subject to violence like this, it tends to be from the most disadvantaged communities where young people have been exposed to violence at an early age. And the key thing about this is not necessarily about stop and search, but stop and engage. It's about engagement in communities, about involvement of young people and understanding the real issues the communities have. In London, the communities that are the most disadvantaged are our black community. But across the country, there's a different ethnic mix.
Well, somebody pointed that in Liverpool. There's a lot of knife crime in Liverpool, apparently. I haven't seen the numbers on this, but someone from Liverpool saying this.
Lots of problems, gangs in Liverpool.
A lot of it is white, right? So it's clearly the different issues in different parts of the country. Glasgow was predominantly a white knife crime issue, right? So it's not. It's really about each individual area and why particularly it's happening to certain parts of the community, I think, right?
But
it's a common theme.
Yeah.
Poverty, disenfranchised communities, government failure.
Education failure.
I mean, is that the common theme wherever you go in the country, regardless of skin colour?
It's a common theme globally. And I think the disadvantaged communities, particularly inequity of access to education, housing, particularly employment opportunities. And employment opportunities, they're a reality. You just can't just tell young people to be resilient. Mm-hmm. You have to actually genuinely create realistic
opportunities. Let me just ask Justin, because you've shown a lot of passion today, and I understand it. I've had a lot of it directed at me on Twitter, and I think that's perfectly reasonable, right? I am not I'm not a black man. I don't know how you feel about stop and search and issues like this. I don't know how it would feel to be targeted because of the colour of my skin and the way that you say that has happened to your son and others. What do you... You've been at the sharp end of this for a long time, right? What is, in your view, the thing that could be done right now to try and facilitate real change? Sadiq Khan says it'll take a generation. I don't think that's acceptable. No. Well, what is the key thing we can do?
I mean, I'm a London bus, was a London bus driver. I bought my own bus, put a studio on it, and I worked with two gangs because a young person was killed in my area. Mm. And he was someone that went to university part-time to care for his mum, who was quite sick. Mm. It affected me because he was known as that guy that really looks after his mum. So that's when I set my project up. I emailed Sadiq Khan, I emailed TfL, and I said, I don't think you've got too many London bus drivers that are buying their own bus to facilitate what I saw then as a problem. So can you please give me some kind of help? Got a nice email back saying no, OK? Fast forward 5 months later, my own son's nearly killed, right? So, obviously, for me, when that happened, obviously, my whole thing is obviously to try and get my son where he needs to be in his recovery process. And then I've got to respond. My response is a positive one. I need to go back into these communities and work with at-risk young people. I've been doing this for a long time. And a lot of the recommendations, a lot of people here, you'll know, they've been involved and active in the community for a long time. Our voices have never been heard. We've never been given this platform to explain the work that we're doing and also to say we need help, you know? Mm-hmm. So it's interesting that it's taken so many deaths to happen before now we've finally reached a point where, OK, now let's have a conversation.
Just to
add, I feel that all of the high-risk young people that I'm working with, the first places, for me, where they've turned into what we're dealing with now is school. They're expelled. We need to stop expulsions immediately. Mm. Before there's any expulsions, schools need to show intervention. Because once you leave a young person unsupported, they find like-minded individuals.
What viewers will be saying, hearing that is, well, what about parental responsibility? Where is that? Why are these kids behaving in such an unruly manner that they get expelled?
Alison, you wanted to make
a point. I was just going to say what you just said there about a platform to be listened to. They don't listen. I've been involved in Home Office campaigns on the panel for consultation. And I was just the tick box of grieving parent. I said, these campaigns will not work. We need to be explaining to the parents how to look after their children, the risks their children face that they're not aware of, the school, the communities, the police, and they just ignore what we say. The police, the amount of times we say we're here to work with you, but they're not interested in engaging with people like us.
Well, I think they increasingly are. I think that they are aware now this is getting out of control, right?
I hope so.
The reason we wanted this panel today was to show that we think this is really important, right? I don't mind it getting animated. I don't mind you showing the passion you show me, right? I don't mind being challenged. I don't have the answers.
Let me give you some solutions.
They need to listen.
Sajid Javid says, he wants to give powers. What he could do overnight, open up COBRA. Just like with, so it ties in with
deal
what
with
Lorraine's
talking about. Emergency.
As an emergency,
it is an emergency,
working with coordination of all the different ministries, because it's not just a London problem, it's all across this country.
And that's if it was terrorism, trust me,
would be a very different way. Secondly, it ties in with the exclusion. Will tell you, you reduce exclusions and there's a serious reduction in knife crime. They reduced exclusion by 80% and it contributed to the 40% reduction in knife crime. Mm. Also, the narrative. You can change the narrative by don't just say trying to scare people into submission to drop the gun or the knife. You tell them that they are the centre of it and work with them and proper intervention
support
and prevention
them.
Programs.